Please welcome Robert Plant. Welcome to Sweden, to Stockholm.
Thank you. I haven't been here for, I think, two and a half years, yeah.
You actually recorded an album here once.
Apparently. it is a funny show, isn't it? I used to catch the bus to Polar Studios on a morning with the bass player John Paul Jones from Led Zeppelin. We used to go to Polar Studios, the home of Benny and Bjorn. It was an experiment, and it was an experiment in as much as we were contacted by your Swedish luminaries, and they said, would Led Zeppelin like to come and record free of charge? Now, we like to look after our money. with our investments in pharmaceuticals, we had very little left, you know. So we used to catch the bus and go to Polar Studios, and we recorded our very last studio album there, yeah.
And did you get to know Benny and Björn?
At night time, yeah.
At night time?
Mostly night time.
So you were out on...
Well, we didn't know our way around the demi-monde of the town, so we pressed Benny and Bjorn into taking us out and about. It was, yeah, they were very hospitable. Showed us Stockholm.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The sort of pop gods meets the rock gods. It's incredible, you know.
Well, we were just all gods then. There was no differentiation, really. I mean, we were all. And look where we end up, you know, whores. Well, me. Anyway.
Not at all.
No.
You still have contact with any of them?
Well, Benny's coming to our show tonight. We're playing at. Yeah. Annexed, so.
We've been talking about touring. And I wonder, and also to tour in different cultures. With your touring experience, I wonder, how have you experienced the different cultures?
I did play some peculiar places. I played in Hong Kong after Led Zepp in the early 80s, and I played at the gig, and I hadn't had many gigs then. So the culture was to embrace Western music, but people didn't really have a clue of how to respond to it. So I played this loud music and did a lot of preening. Mm-hmm. And the audience was full of boys because it was supposed to be rock, so therefore there'd be no girls. And the boys had heard that at shows you scream. So I was singing to 3,000 screaming boys, which... Well, I didn't tell anybody else
it's
that
like
until
the Beatles,
now.
But it's just boys instead.
Yeah, yeah. It was a bit tough then for me, yeah. There were lots of very, very interesting and peculiar. And each country has its own way. Like, once upon a time up here and further up and further down, the Scandinavians took to the weed. So it would be very difficult to applaud when everybody was particularly stoned. So there's a great thing from, I don't know whether it's Danish TV or whatever, of Led Zeppelin in black and white, and people are trying to clap along, but they're completely missing their hands. It's a bit like that film, The Jerk, you know, you can't quite get there. And that condition's now moved down to Holland, where it's going along very nicely. In Switzerland, once we played, I played in a field full of mud, and with Sting, and says you're right. And everybody, if they like you, they go ooh. So you got 25,000 people covered in mud going, which is a mark of term of endearment. You know, I think it was a very nice thing
incredible.
To do.
Incredible. Mm. You've been touring a lot. Do you experience this? Well,
I'm touring now with my show around Norway. But as I told you, I bring my wife with me. My wife says if you go on your own, you either get divorced or you become an alcoholic. So she followed me. That's the most safe thing to do, she says.
I'm divorced.
You are divorced. Yeah. It's because of the touring.
No, it's because I got lucky, I think. I mean, it was only 28 years ago, so I suppose it's time to change spots.
Is it a big difference between touring before and touring today?
Well, I never had an afternoon nap until recently. Yeah, I don't look as good as this always, you know. I've just been sleeping in a dark room. Yeah, I was awake a lot longer in the old days, you know. I was very stimulated.
But perhaps...
but, yeah, I mean, it's much better now, in truth. I mean, it was chaos then. Nobody... There was no book. There was no handbook. There was nobody knew what was going on. You didn't know where you were or where you were supposed to be or where you'd been. And when you got home, you couldn't remember what you'd done to tell anybody what it was like. And they gave you some money, but you probably spent that before you got back.
So you can't actually remember throwing those televisions out of the hotel window?
I think that was Leonard Cohen. Oh, I don't know who it was, but it was nothing to do with us. We've got everything that went wrong was blamed on us because we never did any press.
It's been said that you had more sophisticated groupies.
Oh, who said that?
I read it. Some journalist said that.
Well, I suppose there were one or two girls who were excellent at gymnastics and handicrafts and pharmaceuticals. There was a lot. Gardening was a very strong thing. There was a magazine in the 50s called Health and Efficiency. It always had some girls on the beach throwing a beach ball. We got their moms, you know.
You're here tonight with a band of joy, which is a very critically acclaimed project. And you always seem to move on, because the last thing you did was with Alison Krauss, and you got 5 Grammys for that album. But then you don't want to copy yourself. I don't know why you don't do that, because you could really... You have a lot of things you could now do again, and you don't have to... I mean, why invent something new?
Well, I'm not inventing it. I worked for a year with Alison and alongside Buddy, who's my co-pilot in this project. And every night we used to talk about American music and how magnificent it is. Being British, you know, the British music scene forever has always looked west to America for its inspiration, you know, or now into North Africa quite a lot, you know. And so being around Buddy Miller was something real special, and we talked about music, talked about it, and then when the time came to work, we had the opportunity to get together, and Buddy brought along Patty Griffin and, you know, Daryl Scott, and it's good fun. It's very young. It's in its embryonic stages, and we laugh a lot. And Patty laughs at me a lot because with the Led Zeppelin songs, although we modify them, if I go into character a little bit, she thinks it's very funny, and I can't keep a straight face, you know. And the audience thinks it's great, but I'm going, ah. Here we go. It's that old joke again, you know. When is a door not a door? When it's a jar, you know.
But how do you react when if you stand in an elevator and you hear a version of Stairway to Heaven?
Well,
does the elevator turn into an elevator to hell for you, or is it?
No. I mean, something happens every day, you know. I mean, that song was written one day, and it has a kind of piety, which was appropriate at the time, but. You know, now the twang's the thang. You know, those days were those days. And however, when you write songs, you can, if you write them in the abstract, they work for a period of time. And then after that, you see right the way through to the next part of your life. Inshallah.
Inshallah.
I don't know how you would say it, but what is, how does one not age with dignity in this business? I suppose you think a lot about that.
I think you just got to do what you're comfortable with. And once upon a time, I was in the kitchen all the time. And now I put my shirt on and I'm, you know, I'm waiting to be taken out for a walk.
And I must say, you have changed rock and roll. You have changed the face of rock and roll. You have been a huge inspiration and to a lot of brilliant musicians, but also to a lot of fair-haired singers. how does that feel? Do you like all of them?
Well, yeah, I think that, you know, the guys in Led Zeppelin were spectacular players, and, you know, we lost John, but Jimmy and John Paul are still magnificent, and really, it was a serendipity. It was an amazing phenomenon that we got together and did what we did. Honestly, for honesty's sake, not for money or for kudos, but, and then we got into that whole deal, you know. The fair-haired singers, well, I'm in the land of fair-haired singers now, aren't I? They're everywhere.
That's true.
There's one or two nice ones around, but they're not male.
Thank you so much. Julian Treasure, welcome to Stockholm.
Thank you, Frederick.
You're a sound expert, and you're also the author of the book Sound Business.
Yes.
And first of all, is my...